Hey, I'm Kerry Gashura, and welcome to Let It Rip. Welcoming to you from the CUNY TV studios in the shadow of the Empire State Building in New York City. Now, over a year after the Supreme Court overturned Roe v. Wade, conservatives have continued their crusade to police women's reproductive rights. States such as Indiana, Texas, Mississippi, and Alabama have either instituted a complete ban or near complete bans on abortion, with some states going as far as criminalizing abortions. This continued crusade to police a woman's autonomy, especially black women, has had a negative impact on their health. For example, in Ohio, Brittany Watts, who was not even attempting to have an abortion, miscarried after waiting for 8 hours in hospital because hospital officials were worried that treating Watts would raise legal issues related to abortion. Watts was then questioned by the police and charged with a felony. And so as we head into the 2024 election cycle, it remains unclear how much of an impact reproductive rights will influence women of color, particularly black women, who constitute the largest voting bloc in the country, with approximately 97% of them voting Democrat. Now, here to help us discuss the potential impact of reproductive rights on the 2024 elections is New York Assembly Member Jessica González-Rojas and Dr. Jervette R. Ward, Director of the Black Studies Program in the Division of Humanities and the Arts at the City College of New York. I'm Kerry Gashura, and this is Let It Rip. Assembly Member, we'll go ahead and start with you. I recently heard that you just came back from the Dominican Republic with regard to reproductive rights. Mm-hmm. Just tell us a little bit about that, please.
Yeah, I went on a delegation trip with a number of state elected officials alongside the State Innovation Exchange and the Women's Equality Center. And what we wanted to see and understand is, what would life be like living under a total abortion ban? The Dominican Republic has a constitutional ban on abortion, and what we saw was so tragic. We met with a mother whose 16-year-old daughter has leukemia, and when they were treating her leukemia, they discovered that she was 4 weeks pregnant. 4 weeks pregnant. This is a clump of cells. They refused to provide chemotherapy, and that 16-year-old girl and her fetus died. We met another woman whose sister was sent home when she continually had pain regarding a wanted pregnancy, and later learned that the fetus died inside her, but they would not provide the necessary and life-saving care. Okay. So it was just a tragic situation, and I think speaks to some of the concerns that I'm worried about, and many women and people across the country regarding reproductive rights in this country.
Right, so when we look at the landscape, at least across the United States, particularly with the southern states, some of which have either complete bans or near total bans, you know, can we expect similar results with what we're seeing in the Dominican Republic, or what you saw in the Dominican Republic?
Absolutely. In Texas, we saw a case of a mother who had a wanted pregnancy. She was a white woman with privilege, and all the doctors determined that she would need this life-saving care because the fetus was not viable. She was denied that care by the Attorney General of Texas. She ended up having to leave the state to get that care. Brittany Watts, someone who also experienced a miscarriage after not being treated, we're seeing criminalization of her situation. These are cases that are going to elucidate what's going to happen in this country, the United States of America, if we continue to see the states roll back access to reproductive health care.
So, Dr. Ward, I'd like to come to you. What's your take on what happened to Brittany Watts? And give us a little bit of a historical context as to why the criminalization of, you know, particularly with black women, why they're experiencing this sort of feedback in terms of what they're going through with regard to their reproductive rights.
Yes, thank you for literally posing it as the criminalization,
right.
Because it's the criminalizing of women's bodies, of black women's bodies. When we think about what happened with Brittany Watts, her humanity wasn't recognized, right? Her basic rights as a human being, right, to be treated and to be given health care. She's there asking to be treated, and because you had health care providers who were concerned about having pushback or being locked up or any of the things that they might have experienced, they did not want to recognize her humanity and treat her as human. And this follows a long trajectory of how black women and black women's bodies have been treated inside of the United States. And I thought it was very interesting when you talked about how this is very specific to southern states when we're seeing some of the legalization and the rollback of rights that are happening there. And I'm not saying that it's not happening in northern states, because I never want to give the North a pass as a southerner. Mm-hmm. I'm from Memphis, so I very much know that it can happen in all states. But if you think about what's happening in Mississippi and Tennessee and Alabama and Georgia and Texas, as you mentioned, you can see these long connections to what happened before the Civil War, during Reconstruction, where you're seeing Black women's bodies that were before the Civil War, of course, were property that were used for reproductive rights, mm-hmm. that were used for property rights and pleasure, as some scholars have pointed out. And we're almost seeing a return to that, of saying, we want to police your bodies in the same ways that we've been able to do throughout history. And it's also connected to some larger medical issues. If you think about what's happening in Mississippi in particular, with the rollbacks towards Medicaid and Medicaid care in Mississippi, and how the governor in Mississippi is shutting down hospitals in the Mississippi Delta, which directly affects Black women in particular. This is part of a much larger campaign towards the denying the humanity and the rights of women, Black women, and a lot of citizens in general.
Yeah. Right. No, great points. Assemblymember, let me come back to you. So when we think about what Dr. Ward just said in terms of understanding that the North might be slightly more progressive than the South and not wanting to give the South a pass. You know, what is it that Northern states, particularly New York State, have done to address some of the issues that women of color, and particularly Black women, have experienced?
Well, it's really exciting to see that when women and women of color in particular get into office, we see these policy change. In fact, for decades, the abortion was in the penal code in New York State. And in 2019, when we saw a resurgence of women and women of color get elected into these positions, we passed the Reproductive Health Act, which enshrined abortion in our statute. We recently just passed the Equality Amendment, which would ensure that we enshrine it in our Constitution. It has to go to the voters in 2024, but we are confident we will win. We've passed numerous pieces of legislation that protects and holds the right to abortion. But one thing that's important to me and to ensuring that everyone has access to abortion, if you have the right to abortion but without access to that right, meaning without money, resources, if you are undocumented and can't travel, it is important that we make investments to allow folks to get that care. So I am the sponsor of a bill called the Reproductive Freedom and Equity Fund Act that would allow for the state to cover three things. Capacity building for abortion clinics, right, that are receiving more patients, coverage for uncompensated care or for people who are uninsured, and three, grants to organizations that facilitate access to abortion care, whether it's getting an abortion doula or travel or lodging or childcare, anything that presents a barrier for people either traveling mm-hmm. from other parts of the country or within New York. 39% of counties do not have access to abortion care in New York. So we have a lot of work to do here, but we need to make those investments so that people can get access to the care that they need.
All right, great point. But one of the things that you just indicated is that you have certain communities that do not have access mm-hmm. to, you know, abortion clinics and all that. You know, and we see that the financial crunch that, you know, both Governor Hochul and Mayor Adams are talking about, you know, how do you still get those, you know, those communities get the funding that they need to make sure that they have access to abortion clinics? Because, you know, and I think Dr. Ward mentioned it earlier, is that, you know, there's also a sort of class-based analysis that goes into this mm-hmm. where poor folks may not be able to get access to abortion clinics.
Yes.
What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, and I just want to acknowledge the reproductive justice movement that understands all the conditions that people face in getting care has been rooted in Black women and women of color who have fought to ensure that we're looking at class and race and immigration status and all the other conditions that impact someone's ability to get that care. So the fund would cost us about $50 million. That is a drop in the bucket in our $200+ billion budget in New York State. The governor has previously dedicated her own funds up to a tune of $35 million to provide almost two-thirds of what my bill does, provide support to the clinics and to provide support to the providers. The piece that's missing is that practical support needs for those abortion funds that ensure that people get access to those clinics and care. So the money is very small in terms of the great need that we have, but it would really, really help those people who are marginalized from care.
Okay. Dr. Ward, I'd like to come back to you with regard to what this means for Black women going into the 2024 election cycle, particularly with the fact where we see Black women are being criminalized at larger rates than white women, and how that will affect their ballot choices in terms of the candidates.
That is a great question. So one, we have to look at the realities that Black women show up at the polls. And I think most of the candidates know this, and definitely the Democratic Party knows this. And this is something that they are actively thinking about. I think some of the most recent stats show that, you know, Black women vote 97% for the Democratic Party. And then if you think about how they show up at larger rates than the rest of the population as a whole. And that's been true for the 2008, 2012, and the 2016 elections. It just keeps happening. I think one of the concerns that we have going into the 2024 election is one that's true for Black women and for voters as a whole. People are not enthused about the current choices that exist.
Right.
And currently, there's been a lot of discussion about how Black women have been, in essence, the moral compass of the United States. That's what we saw happening for elections.
And so when we think about that, this idea that Black women are the moral compass and the backbone of the Democratic Party.
They are then in a position where they're stuck with, okay, almost the, and I hate this phrase, but almost like lesser of two evils kind of thing. And it's not saying, you know, the choice has to be evil, but it's like, this is not the choice necessarily that Black women would want to make, but it's like, if we want to protect women's rights to having the medical care that they need, it's like, here we go again, having to show up and make and vote to keep this country on the track that it needs to be kept on.
So even when we think about that idea that, you know, you have a choice of lesser of two evils and that ultimately you have to go with the lesser evil, but Biden's numbers are slipping and slipping really fast amongst, you know, black voters. Is it fair to say that he has just not been as responsive to what Black folks really need? Or, and I would even say, if you look back at, you know, the CARES Act, the Build Back America plan, you know, all those, whatever was available to folks being ended. And, you know, you talk about SNAP and WIC benefits, those are off the table now. You know, do Black folks, particularly Black women, do they still feel a certain level of loyalty to someone who's not fighting for them as much as they would expect?
Well, you have to think about the fact that Black women, in addition to thinking about their medical care, are also thinking about their educational rights, right? And Biden ran on this major campaign of thinking about student loan forgiveness and thinking and saying that he was going to take care of these major financial burdens. And Black women, of course, are one of the most educated demographics. That's probably why they're also voting in the ways that they vote, because they are highly informed. And so when you think about the fact that he has not shown up in the ways that he has promised for them, both in medical care, when you're talking about educational opportunities, you're coming to the table and saying, well, what have you done? What are you doing? And it's this opportunity again of like, okay, you're asking us to show up for you again, but when are you going to, you know, in essence, put your money where your mouth is?
But is he going to be able to claw his way back up? I mean, essentially running against somebody who's, you know, has a ton of criminal charges against him, who's still polling.
Well, not in Colorado, at least.
Well, he's off the ballot there, right? But I'm just wondering whether Biden has enough time to be able to come back to the table with something substantial that both Latinx and Black voters can say, okay, we're going to go ahead and give you the same kind of support that we gave you back in 2021, I think. Assembly member?
Yeah, I think it's also a messaging problem, right? We have to get out the word of the accomplishments he's made. It is, again, Black women who are the backbone of the Democratic Party, and we need to ensure that they're not taking that community for granted. Mm-hmm. And that's my concern about with Democrats, that they're taking many communities for granted. So making sure that they understand the benefits of the Inflation Reduction Act, right? That's something that's really important. The savings that we've benefited from, the climate justice benefits from that, those all have to be better messaged to our communities because it is young people of color who are on the front lines fighting for climate justice.
Isn't there a sense that Biden has essentially failed to deliver on some of the things that he promised? So when you think about the student loan forgiveness, you know, rather than just issue an executive order, he chose to means test it, which was then challenged in court. Even some of the legislation that you just discussed, some of it was kind of rolled back as a compromise to Republicans. And so there's a sense that he is not really in it to fight or in it to win it for the folks who have supported him the most. What are your thoughts?
I think there's a poll that just came out that said number one issue amongst the voters was democracy, saving democracy, and number two was abortion. And I think that's something that he needs to drive home, and it would be really critical to ensure that that message gets out to the community. Amongst women, abortion is gonna be the number one issue. So again, this is an administration that has done good on those areas, and again, we need to message that out. And for folks like me who are in the state legislatures, we need to make sure that we're fighting to protect abortion care and access to abortion care, and make sure that we're addressing the rollbacks that are happening in states across the country. And he needs to be more vociferous on this issue because it is women of color who care about this.
Okay. I want to thank our two guests, Assemblymember Jessica González-Rojas and Dr. Jervette R. Ward. Now, when we come back, we'll be in conversation with the Republican strategist, Vanessa Simon, to discuss whether it's time for black voters to consider the Republican Party as a viable alternative to the Democratic Party. I'm Kerry Gashuro, and this is Let It Rip. Hey, I'm Kerry Gashuro, and welcome back to Let It Rip. Now, a recent New York Times poll showed that President Joe Biden was trailing Donald Trump in five of the six important battleground states. Particularly concerning for Biden was that his support amongst black and Latino voters was waning. The poll raised questions as to whether black voters are dissatisfied with the president's performance, that they would rather vote for Donald Trump, or whether black voters are finally tired of the Democratic Party and its inability to concretely address issues such as poverty, housing, student debt forgiveness, and health care. Now, here to help us discuss whether Republicans may be a viable alternative to disillusioned black Democratic voters is Vanessa Simon, a Republican strategist who is also leading a major campaign effort for the GOP to attract more black and brown voters. Welcome.
Thank you for having me.
We're excited to have you. So given the national narrative that, Republicans are, hell-bent on undoing some things, we still have, like the mayor of Dallas who recently flipped from Democrat to Republican. What does that say about the future of the Republican Party and black voters?
I think it says more about the communities no longer wanting to be under Democrats than it does them wanting Republicans, per se. It's the change that they want. I think that that's a cry. It's not only there. It happened in Atlanta as well. You're seeing a lot of people being like, what is going on? Where's the return of investment? Voting for these Democrats, but still feeling the same pain points throughout their tenure.
And so what are Republicans going to offer black voters and Latinx voters that the Democrats have not been able to offer?
Addressing quality of life. I mean, we talk about the lack of big government, having the government control and oversight, and really bringing the power back to the people in communities.
Okay.
We have black communities that we strive with being entrepreneurs. Where is that presence from the Democratic Party providing those options? I'm from Southeast Queens.
Gotcha. Right? But so. What do you say to critics who are saying Republicans are against women's reproductive choices, right? They have not been able to present a cogent plan when it comes to health care. In fact, southern states have denied Medicare expansion. When you think about education, there hasn't been a significant support from Republican candidates to support student debt relief or anything like that. So what's your response to that?
My response is just doing the due diligence of looking into what more Republican candidates are saying and doing. I think we have a few that are highlighted that don't represent the whole party. Like I myself don't share those sentiments. Being a Republican, I am pro-choice. I'm open about it. And I think that it shouldn't be addressed with one broad stroke. Like right. All Republicans feel this way.
But Republicans are not. Right. When you look at the National Republican Party, you know, they're running against some of the issues that I just highlighted. And then there's this ethno-nationalist sentiment that's, you know, been very, very prevalent amongst the Republican Party. I mean, you look at the speaker, you know, Mike Johnson, you know, he not only denied the election results and said that there should be a recount, but he's also been very, very much against women's reproductive rights. You know, so. Isn't it difficult for voters to say we think that the Republicans may be able to answer some of the things that the Democrats have not been able to?
I think it's difficult because of the decision made around, obviously, reversal of Roe v. Wade, the lack of civics education around that. It was just returning the power back to states. And I think that that was the biggest misconception because people don't understand that. They just immediately thought, oh, Republicans are against abortion. When in actuality, it's like, no, each state should decide for their communities and you vote the leader in play. You know what I mean? But it became that dialogue.
Right, but when you think about it, that has been something that they have been pushing, particularly in the southern states. I mean, sure, you can look at New York and say, you know, they were able to enshrine it in their constitution. But don't women in southern states also have the ability to independently make choices that, you know, for their bodies?
But that goes back into making sure that everyone is taking their part and playing their role and just knowing what's going on in local politics and voting the right leaders in place, right? It doesn't mean that they have to elect the leader that selects that they're against abortion. You could have someone like me who's a Republican, but I'm more pro-choice. But then again, I am in New York. But you don't know if that exists in a southern state.
Okay.
I think a lot of people just categorize politics and just, I want nothing to do with politics. But when, you know, when you don't do politics, politics does you.
Right.
And those decisions are made,
right.
And unfortunately.
I think most people will agree to that. But how do you reconcile the naked racism within the Republican Party? How do you then say to black folks and Latinx folks, say, hey, I think our party has something to say and do with regard to what you need. But on the other hand, they're coming out and saying some really, really racist and doing some racist things.
I think, to be frank, there's some members within our party that get the national stage. But when you get back to family, values, faith, that's what unites us as conservative values in the Republican Party, right? So getting back to places where you're looking for representatives that represent your area, and that's where I do put a little onus on the GOP to do better, selecting candidates that represent the communities that the people are from, whether it's black and brown communities, it doesn't matter. We have to do a better job selecting on a grassroots level, connecting back with the people.
Okay, but how do you push against that narrative, given your campaign now, to try and attract more black and Latinx voters to the GOP? Because how do you push back against the national narrative, even if it's at a local level?
Here's the thing, it's a long game. And it's one of those things where it has to be grassroots, rolling up your sleeves, and that's something that the GOP hasn't done well. You know, so that's been my battle cry. Let's get back into neighborhoods. You should be dealing and selecting people that are from the areas that you're trying to kind of get more, drive more impact, be more involved in. And that's not where we're at right now as the GOP. Right. So for me, I really work on that outreach. Also leveraging college kids because I'm really big on engaging Gen Z, millennials. Speaking to Gen Zers, they feel so out of touch with the GOP. So open, honest conversation needs to be had. But to answer your question, we got to do a better job and dive into these communities.
Okay, understood. Well, thank you so much. That was a great discussion, but we'll have to end it there. So I just want to thank our guest, Vanessa Simon. And when we come back, we'll take a look at two women who worked hard to reshape the political and economic landscape for black people in America. I'm Carol Gashuro, and this is Let It Rip. As we head into the 2024 elections, I'm reminded of two phenomenal women, Fannie Lou Hamer and Shirley Chisholm, who both understood the importance of the electoral arena as a tactic to enfranchise black voters and to pursue racial and economic justice. Fannie Lou Hamer worked as an organizer with the Student Nonviolence Coordinating Committee to register voters in Mississippi and co-founded the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party, which challenged the state Democratic Party's right to seat an all-white delegation at the National Democratic Convention. Realizing the limits of the political arena, Hamer focused her efforts on economic independence, where she launched the Freedom Farm Cooperative, which would allow black people to own land and farm collectively. And who can forget Shirley Chisholm, who was elected to the New York State Legislature, where she championed legislation that included open admissions at CUNY. With a campaign slogan for Congress, Unbought and Unbossed, which indicated that she was independent, principled, and fearless, Chisholm went on to be the first black woman elected to Congress, and where she was a co-founder of the Congressional Black Caucus. But Chisholm didn't stop there. She went on to be the first black presidential candidate who aimed to build a voting coalition that would include black, female, poor, and young folks. And as we head into the 2024 presidential elections, I recall Fannie Lou Hamer's quote,
"We are sick and tired of being sick and tired."
Because black voters once again find themselves having to make the pragmatic choice of choosing the lesser of two evils at the ballot box. May the spirit of Fannie Lou Hamer and Shirley Chisholm be our guide and inspiration to push this two-party system to do right by all people. I'm Carol Gashuro, and this is Let It Rip.